the success was really great. We still have no distribution.
Well, obviously the internet and Netflix has changed everything.
And we sold it for $1 million.
We did it on our own. And we've grossed over, we're almost at $600,000.
$12,000 to $20,000, somewhere in that range, in order to be able to secure those two locations for 1 week.
Distributors, not all of them, but a lot of them would just refuse to pay until you sued them, because they knew you didn't have any money.
We're realistic. These films are never going to be in theaters. They're not going to be a big theatrical draw. They're for niche audiences, and they're made for online audiences.
Just how difficult it is if you're waiting to be picked out of the crowd by the big festival or by the big distributor to be part of the 0.004% for whom that happens.
We made the film, then we cut a trailer. The trailer online, and it got 2.3 million global hits. And we said, we have something, we have something. So let's see if we can get a touring company to, and they did, we got a touring company, tourists around the country and different parts of the world, and the success was really great. We still have no distribution. And so we said, okay, let's get a broker, maybe a booker, and maybe the booker can set up some screenings and how much is it going to cost us. As we're going into the cost for the booker to maybe, say, 5 or 6 AMC theaters or something, man, between the booking and the promotion, and can't afford, we're dry. Good run. Went to the film festivals and so on. Get a call on the phone. Oprah Winfrey's interested in you guys screening the film for her. Okay. Send it to Scott over there. And Scott looked at it, brought it to Oprah's office, saw it, and he said, what's your lawyer's name? And once that happened, I'm not gonna lie, man, it was painful, man. Some days you want to just say, forget it, man, give up.
What about it was painful? And what time frame are we talking about?
Year and a half. I mean, you're talking about, you know, your bank account is dry, and you got bills to pay, and your accountant's pissed at you to the degree of something's wrong with you. You spent this money for your mortgage this year, and where's that going to come from? You're crazy. You start thinking, maybe I was a little crazy. And then divine intervention, or whatever you want to call it, says, you're doing something that we want you to do, so we're going to help you. And when that happens, it's like, first time we take a deep breath in a long time. But you can't give up. It's the blessing and curse of this industry. You know, it's a blessing and a curse. I mean, you keep going because you're passionate and you're going to get it done. You know, but it's not painless. And then when someone sees what you see, and they have distribution, and they say it has value. Tears, and I don't mean the polite type, you know, the snotty type, you know, that kind of stuff that really, just thankful.
Did wordplay make you a millionaire?
No. No, wordplay did not make us a millionaire. It's funny you should ask that, because when we that was our first film, and we took it to, we got accepted to Sundance in 2006, took it to the festival, and there was a very intense bidding war for that film. We ended up with seven offers on the table from, you know, all the big distributors. And we sold it for $1 million. We had only spent a little over $100,000 to get the movie to Sundance. Okay, so we spent a year making it, We spent about $100,000 and change to make that cut of the film. And we sold it for $1 million. And I remember telling our agent at Sundance, our agent is John Sloss from Cinetic Media. I said, I'm really worried about selling our film for $1 million. I'm afraid that, you know, we're gonna be one of those infamous films that come out of Sundance, like, oh, they paid too much and that movie underperformed. And like, I didn't wanna have all that. I was like, we should sell it for less. He's like, no. He's like, first of all, $1 million is not that much money for a movie. He's like, you've made a really good film that a lot of people wanna see. So that's the right price, and you know, and you have it. It's we already have a deal. We already shook hands on this deal. What I didn't know was that after Sundance, you know, Sundance is in January, and we were in theaters, we were in about 500 theaters that summer in June. We came out in June later on that year. We had a lot of work to do on the film between selling it and releasing it. We had to film out. We had to pay for that. It was $100,000, over $100,000 to film out. We had to license all the music. We did a lot more graphics. We did a lot more editing. It really started to add up. And by the time we were sitting in the theaters on opening night at the IFC Center in New York City, we had spent a total of almost $700,000. So do the math. We walked away with $300,000. Now that's great. I mean, if I could do that every year, I would do that every year. Unfortunately, that's not what normally happens. I think on a lot of these films, I mean, I hate to say it because it sounds really discouraging, but I think on a lot of these documentaries, you're lucky even to break even. And what we're finding nowadays is that if you don't have good partners when you go out to make these films, you're really going to be in trouble. On this film, we had, on If You Build It, we had great partners. The Sundance was a big partner. The John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, Film Independent, the Candida Foundation, which is out of the East Coast, the Wincoat Foundation. We did a Kickstarter campaign. We won an Independent Spirit Award. We won the Bright Future Award presented by Unilever Project Sunlight. That was a $25,000 award that we won. I mean, we had an army behind us, really, to make this film. If we didn't have that, we probably wouldn't be sitting here in my house because we probably would have lost our house. We probably would have had to sell our house. I mean, it was so financially challenging for us to make this film. Christine and I and our partner Neil Baer, you know, we've been at this a long time. We've been making movies, and Neil's a tremendously successful television writer and showrunner. And we thought we had it all figured out. And then we made this movie about a small town in North Carolina that took 3 years to make, and it was hard to raise money. I mean, it was challenging. So, you know, wordplay was great, and we made money on that film. And we also sort of launched our film careers at the same time. But I think more often than not, these movies, you do them for other than financial reasons. And if you are lucky enough to make money on a film, more often than not, you fold that into your next project and it's tied up in the next one. So yeah, it's great. If anyone is thinking about like becoming a millionaire, I wouldn't recommend making documentary films because it's very unusual that would be the case. It could happen, but mm-hmm. more often than not, it won't.
Not with distributors.
Why?
Are we ready to go that? Yeah?
Well, there's a, we are meeting, there'll be distributors, this won't be out before tonight. So there are distributors, there are people who are coming to see Anderson Bench tonight. But we're talking about meeting with theaters. I've done this one time before.
Can we also interject real quick?
Certainly we can. What would we like to say?
Well, we would like to say.
The royal we.
Right. You have to kind of go back to how the vaudeville days were. Do you know what I mean? And then that kind of gives people a little bit more insight, which is taking into the road shows, doing the Mike Todd things.
Was it called a truck and pony? Truck and pony show? What's the expression?
It was a dog and pony
show. Dog and pony show?
A dog and pony show.
But there was a bus and truck was...
Right.
When you do
there was also
theater,
pedaling.
It's a bus and truck. Or you pedal.
You pedaled. So they had theater owners that would pedal. They would bicycle. And they would start
pedal their print right. to the next theater.
And they owned groups of theaters. And so it's... there are still theater owners. There are theater owners like
there
that.
There are still theater owners.
There are theater owners like that in the South or the Southern region. I don't know many in the North. But anyway, that own theaters. And so back then you would bicycle. One, you would start off at one theater, and that reel was bicycled to the next theater so you could start the movie in that theater. So they would own one print. It's kind of taking...
And you know I actually did that, right?
You bicycled?
Well, I was in my Dodge truck, but yeah.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. But that's where that comes from. Mm-hmm. It's from the original single screen movie theater owners, and it was called bicycling.
Right, pedaling. You'd pedal from one place to the other.
So anyway, go ahead with your
story. So that's an old, that's where moment. Things, that's right. This educational moment brought to you
Mike
by
Todd.
A bicycle. I believe that there's a way around everything. There's a way around it that the entire industry has changed. It's easier to make movies now. The only thing it's not easier to do now is to get distribution, because the same people are in control of distribution. And God bless them. There's nothing wrong with that. But it's corporate people or... not necessarily creative people, non-creative people, at the very last stage of a creative process. That makes no sense. That by the time you get to right just before you're going to bring the birthday cake out with the candles on it, you've got somebody with a fire extinguisher, right? Like going, you can't have that out here. Well, wait a minute, why? It's a birthday cake with candles. No, you can't do that. There are children out there. Yes, it's a child's birthday. Don't you understand? It's a little bit of a tangent. What we believe now is that there are tremendously expensive theater chains out there that are owned by people who are in the movie business. They're on the hook for $40-50 million for a Cineplex because they want to be in the movie business, because they loved Old Yeller, and they loved The Godfather, and they loved Harold and Maude, and they loved Herbie the Love Bug, and loved and loved and loved and loved and loved. But now, because they have a mortgage, and because they have a loan, and they are now being forced to be more in the business model than the show model. And I believe that to be true. Do I have anything to back that up? No, but for me, it seems like common sense. Well, this makes sense. So I think there's a way to make a deal to distribute films directly to cinema owners, rather than have to go this way, which for me seems like the long way around the barn. Just go right to the people who are selling popcorn and offer them content. Offer them a way to put butts in seats, but offer them a way to be back in the show part of show business. So that's what we're involved in right now. And we may be barking, howling at the moon. I have no idea, but it's worth a try.
Right, we have to, and that's the fun part of it. And I think that we both are like-minded in the sense that we have to make it back to it being an event, and that's why I bring up vaudeville. It was always the juggler before the show, or this or that before the show, and there's a lot of connecting parts that we're talking about, but it's connecting with those theater owners who have been in business since the 1920s, 30s, and 40s. They're family.
Yeah, these are the grandchildren of people who started, who built the first theater.
Right, and it's really taking them the content and then creating this event. And I don't want to say it all because there's certain connecting elements that we're doing, but
there's a lot. There's a whole lot to it.
It is a road show type.
Yeah.
Venue.
We did something very unique with our theatrical distribution. We did it on our own, and we've grossed over. We're almost at 600,000. But excuse me, that's gross. That's not our take. What essentially we've done is we've done one screening at a time. And what we would do is our first really big screening. Well, our first theatrical screening was in Ashland, Oregon. And we had been in the film festival there and we sold out all our screenings. So we said, okay, this is a great market to go back. Clearly people want to see this film. And we were just so amazed with no advertising really to speak of. They extended us for 6 weeks. And what we do is I usually try and show up for opening weekend. I come armed with 2 500 flyers and ask everybody to help us spread the word, take 10 flyers and pass them out. And so our method has really been word of mouth, and we really ask people to help us. And then we also do outreach. We do before the film is going to be showing in a city, we'll reach out to outdoor stores, churches, any walking groups, yoga studios, and we try and do a lot of grassroots outreach. And what we did is each screening essentially funds the next one. And then the other really unique thing that we did is I financed an RV, had it wrapped with our logo, and then I did a whole cross-country tour. I literally went all the way around the country. There was one section, 2 week section that Annie took on for me, thank God, because I was getting pretty tired at that point. But pretty much we went all the way across around the country. And I'm thinking, we're guessing that I've probably appeared somewhere at like 100 different events, 100 different cities, and done over 200 Q&As, that number. So it's really been about appearing and trying to enlist local people to help us spread the word. And I also think there's a real desire in our country right now. I've heard somebody refer to it as spiritual dehydration. A real longing for more meaning in our lives. And to go to a movie that's uplifting and inspiring rather than depressing and disturbing. So I think people are ready for that. There's something I'd like to address. So for me, it was really important to show it in theaters because my intention in making the film was to bring the Camino to people so that they could have a Camino experience just sitting in their chair. It wasn't about trying to inspire everybody to go do the Camino, but it was having everybody at least get a glimmer or a sliver of the lessons and of the magic of the Camino, which would inspire them to do whatever they're meant to do, be it go walk the Camino or open a homeless shelter or spend more time with their grandchildren. And for me, seeing it in a theater was particularly important because it sort of mimics the Camino experience. You're having this semi-intimate experience with a bunch of strangers. And also being on the big screen, you get much more of a sense of being there, of being on the Camino. Oh, I absolutely do not think theatrical is dead. I think people really long for that night out, going out and sharing an experience. Maybe it's just a subconscious desire to share an experience with people, but I really think there's something very special about being in that dark room, no interruptions, you know, the baby's not crying, the dog's not thrown up, the phone's not ringing. I mean, you're really there to step into that experience. And I think no matter how big our TVs get, you're not gonna have that same experience at home. I think we were very blessed. It was sort of a perfect storm in a positive way because we had a film that people
with this film, people can say, so often when you walk the Camino, you come home and people are like, how was it? And it's like, you can't even begin to talk about it. You can't, how do you even start to explain it? And this was one of the reasons I made the film as well, was this way people could say, watch this. That's what I went through. Now, obviously, I can't touch on every experience or every person's, but there's some general themes that everybody that walks goes through. And I tried to capture as many of those as possible. And so we had that element. So very frequently, people come to see our film once, like somebody that's walked, they'll come and see it once, and then the next night they'll bring three friends, and then two nights later they'll bring, you know, their brother and their sister-in-law and two other people, because they want to be able to share their Camino experience with people. And there's just been this huge increase of interest and of people walking the Camino. And so there's a wonderful organization called American Pilgrims here in the US, and they have separate pilgrim chapters all over the country. So we worked very closely with those chapters. And so they would get all their friends, and they would usually use it as an event to help people that are thinking about doing the Camino. Okay, these are some of the things that you might encounter if you do the Camino. And so we had that going for us. We had the fact that The Way had come out previously. So there was literally thousands of people that had gone and walked the Camino from when they saw The Way to when our film came out. And additionally, I think that spiritual dehydration, I think a lot of people are really excited about seeing a film where nothing blows up and nobody gets murdered. I mean, I'm the first one. I love my TV shows and, you know, kind of escapist movies, but to a point, you know, I really do enjoy something that makes me feel good. I was really inspired by What the Bleep, because they didn't go the normal route. They didn't get into film festivals. They didn't get into, or lots of them, they got into some, and they didn't have a big production company behind them. They didn't have a big distributor. Now, they did have a much, much bigger budget than we did, but they still had a very self-distribution model. But there wasn't a ton of information about it. But as, I guess it was when we were at the Hollywood Film Festival, where we won Best Documentary, our DVD distributor introduced me to Betsy Chassie, one of the creators of What the Bleep. And she's just been lovely. She's been like a mentor to me and really encouraging. But I can't say there was an exact model. I mean, I did read a lot of books and I got little pieces from lots of different things. And I also, a lot of the making of this film and the distribution of this film has really happened on an intuitive level. I just kind of get this sense, or I'm like, this would be a good thing to do. And I've learned to trust that. And that's been a big part of my Camino, and what I've learned is really to trust my intuition. And so the big part of it was I should get an RV. And if I'm, and to me, so many filmmakers are like, oh, I just want to make the film. But to me, it's kind of like birthing a baby and then giving it up for adoption. I mean, it's a choice to do, but to really make sure that the film gets out in the world in the way you want it to. Like, for example, I mean, for me, theatrical was important because I really feel like people can have the whole experience. And I also can't imagine that many distributors would have done with it the way I did it. And it was a very personal touch, obviously.
What would you say the bulk of the $25,000 that you raised for Walter on Kickstarter was spent on?
So the bulk of the money raised on Kickstarter was definitely spent on this Academy qualifying campaign, and specifically the commercial releases in New York and LA. There are ways to four-wall commercial release, and we are four-walling our commercial release. So, which is tough, because you walk into LA, New York, in our specific case, it's going to be a little different depending on if you're getting daytime slots or evening slots. But as of right now, I mean, it's, you know, you're looking at probably $12,000 to $20,000 somewhere in that range in order to be able to secure those two locations for 1 week. And you're talking anywhere, I mean, you're talking like 14 to 21 screenings at each location for that kind of money. So if you've got a film that's not going to get a lot of audience, and we know going into it, we're not going to get a ton of audience doing it, you're not going to see much of that money come back. That's just money that poofs away. But that money comes back in interesting ways, and this gets back to the idea of investing for the long term, thinking about the long term. And this is an experiment, so I can't speak for sure about this, but my feeling is by giving the film a little bit of a bigger, richer context from the beginning, sort of polishing it up and having it be this type of film that has reviews, whether they're good or not, you know, it's got these reviews, it's got bigger press, and it will ultimately help shape the film for some bigger sales down the road. So I think that money will come back. That's my prediction. And we'll, you know, I'm happy to check back with you guys, but it's pretty scary when you're like, you know, writing these checks and you go, well, shoot, for you know, $15,000, I could put on a heck of a good tour and go to places where we know we could probably fill the theaters and make all that money back and more, and then put that to the film to go forward. But you'll get a bunch of reviews in like small towns like Great Falls, which are great, and they always feel really good, but they don't necessarily speak to the film industry and allow you those film, you know, the film-based opportunities where people want the film and help sell it further on down the road.
So when you were calling these theaters in LA and New York, were you going based on price, or were you going based on which ones actually had ins with getting those reviews in the New York Times, LA Times? What was your strategy?
So our strategy when we set up our commercial releases in New York and LA was first to kind of research and see if other people had done this, which they had. So I started to realize there's actually people that will help broker the deal for you. So if you Google around, yeah, you'll find somebody who can kind of help you, and it's all part of a package price. I actually went direct to IFC Center and said, hey, because I'd seen in an article, IFC Center helps films qualify for Academy Awards, meaning they will book a film at a four-wall price for a week. Meaning you don't have to go through this weird, convoluted system I still haven't figured out to get a booker to consider your film to get it out there. You know, I'm starting to realize as I do this more and more, it is very controlled by the studios or the distributors that have the money to market these films. So for somebody that's, you know, smaller and has smaller films and doesn't necessarily have a ton of money for P&A, it's going to be very difficult for you to get like conventional theatrical releases out there. But there are these smaller art houses that are starting to realize that in New York and LA, and for a certain kind of price you can get in. So I went to IFC Center first, talked to a guy there about what it would cost, and he started to run some numbers, and I think it was like around, you know, $6,500 for their lowest package, which is daytime. Daytime screenings, you know, you have to be within a certain window to qualify. It has to be after 1 o'clock. So it's not like 10 a.m. screenings, but it's still like you're talking about like pretty early screenings. You could have a 1:15 and a 3:15 screening for your movie, you know, and that's your theatrical launch, you know. We're in a situation where we're like, well, we want an evening slot. We want to definitely have that evening feel for the film and have, you know, some people that we know in the industry and some other people show up and see the film. So we negotiated. We ended up working with a guy in LA that set up both IFC Center and a theater chain here called Lamley that would, you know, ultimately launch our film for, you know, the right kind of times that we liked. So we paid a little extra to get some better times. But I think we're definitely happy to have done that, just have had that experience, and you know, and we actually used the Kickstarter experience and brought it back. I mean, we had people that contributed $200 to be part of our premieres out in New York that showed up, and we got to meet these new people, and you know, they became, I think, hopefully deeper fans. You know, it seems that they were happy with the fact that they put money into helping make this possible, but that ultimately kind of helped us feel like we could throw a little bit of party and have a fun launch out there in New York. And so that was pretty cool to see that play itself out.
So you ultimately did go with a booker in the end?
Yeah. We did, yeah.
You did, uh-huh, okay.
And they've been, you know, it's been an interesting experience working with a booker, you know, and you're kind of trying to figure out the system and they're talking to you about this or that, and, you know, we're dealing with something now where they're trying to switch us out possibly with a different theater here, and so that's a little bit that's a little bit of a challenge last minute, you know, seeing that happen. And I don't know if the Academy wants it that way. Who knows? You know, that's something I'm curious about. I've definitely toyed with the idea of how transparent, like, Sarah and I are going to be about, here's what our experience was like. I mean, it's definitely been an up and down battle. It's been one of those things where it's like, man, should we really be spending the money this way? You know, it's definitely something we think about. But I have convinced myself, and I do feel like it is nice to have a legitimate release for a film and to put the money into that. But, you know, there's a point where you have to think about, like, if you're spending, $15,000 plus all the other expenses for travel and all this other stuff, so over $20,000 to do something, but you're not really seeing much money come back. Economically, it doesn't make any sense in that moment. Again, we'll see down the road with a little bit of smoke and mirrors. You never know, you know. And, you know, somehow if there was ever a chance that we'd get nominated or even shortlisted, it would definitely give us, you know, some attention. And even if it doesn't happen on this film, but maybe it introduces us to the right people and it helps us down the road on another film, you know, maybe that was a gamble that was worth it. So that's the way I look at it, you know. I kind of look back to the Kickstarter moment. This is what we told people we were going to do. That's what we, you know, that's what we built our campaign around, and we want to see it through. So, chalk it up to that.
Outside Sales was, we didn't know what the hell we were doing. That's a very important thing about my first movie. I was doing well acting wise, and like this was the movie that I sold my house to finance. I, you know, had done this cartoon for Disney for where I do the voice of Peter Pan, and I made a good amount of money, and I bought a house, and then I sold the house to finance my first movie, and we had it, and we traveled all over the film festival circuit and spent all this money, and then came out the other side and was like, all right, I'm broke. I don't have distribution for the movie, and, you know, what do I do? So that one was crazy. It took about a year of just, like, talking to everybody, and finally we landed with this company and got a DVD deal, which, again, this was when the system wasn't working very well. So it was like, we got a DVD deal, no money up front, but they threw us a big release party, and that was pretty much it. But the movie was out. That was an important thing. Weather Girl was a way better experience. Weather Girl got into the Slam Dance Film Festival. We had some cool actors. We had Mark Harmon and Caitlin Olson and Trish O'Kelly, who was on The New Adventures of Old Christine, and they all came out to Park City with us, and that helped promote the movie, and we got a distribution deal right there, and then we sold to Lifetime, which was really where the money came in, so that paid back all of our investors. And then we had this huge international deal where they never paid us. So we had to sue this company in order to get them to settle for 1/5 of what they owed us. Again, the system just didn't work. It was the kind of thing where people, the distributors, not all of them, but a lot of them would just refuse to pay until you sued them because they knew you didn't have any money. So if you sued them and got that far, then they would settle for like 1/5 of what they owe you, which is, you know, a lot of the, politically, this kind of business is being talked about a lot right now. And in my experience, it happens all the time of like the little guy screaming, yelling about where's the money that you owe me? And then them saying, no, all right, here, I'll pay you 1/5 and you'll be happy to have it. Luckily, that's happening less now with distributors. But that was Weather Girl. So Weather Girl, we made all of our money back, but before we got into profit, we had this problem with our international distributor. 6-month rule, we premiered at the Austin Film Festival. Film Buff came to us. Film Buff is Cinetic's kind of little brother in the indie film world. And they put us out iTunes VOD and everything like that. It was a great experience. We're still out there with Film Buff. 6-month rule, check it out. And cut to the chase, finished the film, and we've just been traveling film festival-wise and, like, having conversations, and we met with 108 Media, and they seemed down with the movie, and we certainly speak the same language, and they're bringing us out March 7th, so I'm excited.
Walmart is sort of the last man standing, right? It's the last place where there's really meaningful sales of DVDs. When people shifted from buying DVDs to streaming movies, there was a big collapse in revenues for indie films. So think of it this way. Average DVD costs, what, $10 to $15?
Right.
Average streaming is, what, $3 to $5?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Think how many more people need to stream a movie to make up for that deficit. For the same amount of revenue to come back to the distributor, to the filmmaker, you need easily 10 times as many people seeing the film. So when you're a small film and you have a limited audience to begin with, you're collapsing the revenue. The reason that there was such a kind of a huge fecundity in the late 80s and 90s with the advent of VHS and then DVD that suddenly created this whole revenue stream for independent films so that more could then be funded and produced. When that collapsed, the whole business model collapsed, making it a lot harder to make our films and certainly to get them out there with meaningful distribution. So this is a super exciting opportunity for Jack of the Red Hearts, for our filmmaking team, and I hope for a lot of other filmmakers to follow.
How do you get a film financed and how do you get distribution for a film? So that's the main thing. There's no clean-cut way to do either of those things. It's sometimes certain things work and sometimes they don't. Approaching a distributor in advance is something that really helps, especially for this film. What I did is I had my movie Pernicious, which is coming out in theaters soon, that all the distributors saw when it was playing festivals and they had made bids on it. And the distributors that we didn't end up selling the film to, I approached and said, hey, they put in an offer for it, and I said, hey, if I made a film in the same genre, would you buy it? And they said yes, and so they pre-bought the film. And so these films were pre-sold before they were made. It was very easy to finance them based off of they were already sold before they were made. So it's like, hey, once the film is delivered, you get X amount of dollars from the distributor. It's very easy to say, hey, can you finance this, because I'm literally basically borrowing money from you for like a little bit of time and then it comes in.
He said specifically what he's looking for. As opposed to making up a movie that you're like, this is my passion project, it was, here's what the distributor wants.
They basically said, as long as I'm writing and directing, which on one, and then I swung it as a two film deal that I would write both with Zack would direct one and I would direct one. And then they said that it had to be like ghost house type stuff. So like, you know, genre films with a supernatural element. That's what's big right now for genre.
So it was haunted house film with a ghost girl. And inside that niche, we could do whatever we wanted. So we came up with about 12 different concepts, pitched them to him, he chose which ones he liked, and then we wrote them. And we literally wrote them over Christmas. My girlfriend is very, very kind and understanding. So over Christmas, we were locked in our offices, sleeping there, writing 17 hours a day, jamming it out. And we got, we wrote Restoration in 5 days for the first draft. And then Bethany, we wrote in 7 days. And then we both went our separate ways to do our polishes on each. So I directed Restoration, he was gonna direct Bethany. So I polished Restoration, he polished Bethany. So once we had that, we already had the distribution. I talked to my investors, and at this budget, we had a good MG, minimum guarantee. So it wasn't that much of a risk financially. It was a real thing to move forward with, so we did. And it's, you know, it's micro-budget films. It's hard. It's really hard. But we have fantastic crews and wonderful people that we're working with, and then we have begged for every favor we could get. So we then crewed up, cast up, locked it down, and started shooting. And we did them back to back. So we did, we're doing 6 day weeks. Our Restoration was 14 shooting days, 6 day weeks, then 3 days down, and then started Bethany. First 14 shooting days.
Cut!
All right, that's a cut.
I know with your other film,
Oxiana,
mm-hmm. that you premiered at Tribeca, was it? But
yeah.
Then you decided you weren't going to go to any more festivals.
Yeah.
And then with Cam Girls, you premiered at an adult con or something?
Oh, yeah. We just did it. We did a screening at the AVN Awards in Las Vegas, kind of just to dip our toe in the water and show that industry, hey, here's something we made about the adult industry. That industry is huge. It's way bigger than the indie film community. And I'm not making films for festivals. I don't know if I'll ever have a film in a festival again. It's just not something I'm that interested in. I think festivals are something that used to keep us relevant, and now we're kind of there to keep them relevant. And I don't want to be part of some elitist hierarchy or anything like that. And It's also, you know, when you're doing film festivals and you're saying, okay, this is going to be our path and it's going to be the festival route, there's a certain complacency and laziness that comes over you, like, oh, I got my festival laurels, I'm going to be fine now, everything's going to happen for me. But we're not looking for distribution. We are the distributors. So what are we going there and doing necessarily, you know? So the way I saw it is the Tribeca was hugely helpful in getting the word out about Oxiana and helping even getting this film made. But I need a way better argument than the current one about why I should be spending a year on a festival circuit when I could be out making another film.
Well, I think with Oxiana, you determined that a lot of your audience was online.
Yeah, I think the whole audience is online. You know, for all these things, we're realistic. These films are never going to be in theaters. They're not going to be a big theatrical draw. They're for niche audiences, and they're made for online audiences. You know, and even so much so that like we're abandoning the idea of the feature film, and we're just making our films whatever length they kind of need to be. You know, I feel like that's more conducive to the types of people that are watching them and the types of people that I want to watch them.
I think for an independent film, getting it in front of an audience and getting it reviewed by some of the tastemakers, and I think the best tunnel for that to happen is through going to festivals and film festivals. So if you want to go back to before I made features, I made short films. And my final short film that I made at UCLA Film School got to play festivals all over the country, and I made relationships with festivals that way, so that when I had a feature, I was a known quantity, or at least a more known quantity than, say, someone who didn't have any connections in the or relationships in the film festival world. That said, the film festivals select the films based on whether they like you, not whether they like you, but whether they like the film. It just does help, though, to get it in front of the right decision makers sometimes, if you know them already, which is not to say that it gets you in, but it gives you a better chance, because you know that if you have spent a year or 2 years playing film festivals with a short film, they recognize your name, and then you can contact them and say, hey, just in case you miss it, try to look for this movie. Then you have an advocate at that film festival. I'm not saying that that's the only thing that makes it get in, but it does help. Because there is just every year more and more films being made. Anything that you can do to put your film on the top of the stack of the ones they need to watch is obviously to your advantage. As far as distribution goes, I'm hopeful that there's more festivals every year where people will be buying films. But right now, in the United States, there's very few. There's Sundance. There's if you count Toronto, North America, and then there's South by Southwest, Tribeca, maybe even Los Angeles Film Festival. I hope that every year it will grow. The number of festivals where films are bought and put into distribution, because that only helps the independent filmmaker to have more options of places to premiere their movie. So I'm hopeful that every year there's more, but that is really the way that I think right now the system and the industry facilitates a distributor, that and good reviews.
They came to us. We had a very successful screening at the Frameline Festival in San Francisco. We filled the Castro Theater. There were over 1,000 people. It was a thrilling experience. They got every joke. They cried, they laughed, they stood up, they cheered. It was extraordinary. It was extraordinary. And I think someone from Breaking Glass was at that screening, and they approached us. They came to us, and they wanted the film, and they pursued us rather aggressively.
I went after Gravitas, actually.
Oh, okay. The pursuer.
I did. Well, what's great about Gravitas and Film Buff, and I think Go Digital as well, is a bunch of them, they're not really, they're distributors in name only, they're really aggregators. Although they're starting, as these companies grow, they are becoming more distributory. But what they do is they function as an intermediary between Hulu, iTunes, Netflix, pay-per-view cable companies, Showtime, basically companies where they don't want to deal with individual filmmakers. You have to go through a distributor. What they do is they you get from dollar one all the you know, the revenue minus their distribution fee, which is great. They're not trying to recoup costs. They do have a clause to recoup costs, but it's capped very low. It's super reasonable. It's ridiculously low. It's like office costs. And that way you're guaranteed, at least as the film generates income, you're seeing something from the first transaction, which is very different than a traditional distributor where you're getting, they may or may not give you an advance, and they're gonna take everything until they recoup costs, and then you never see a dime. So I think Gravitas has a good reputation for, I mean, first of all, do your research. Go to your Apple TV or iTunes and go to Indie Movies, and every Tuesday and every Friday when they post new trailers and post new movies, and see what's coming out. Look at the trailers, see who the companies are. That's what I did. And Gravitas was consistently present, and they had a nice variety, had a nice wide range of stuff they were releasing. Documentaries, foreign films, indies that were about the same size as Favor, indies that were a lot bigger than Favor. They had a good spread. And in dealing with them, they're very honest, very laid back, and they don't overpromise. That said, with a company like this, you are responsible for most of your advertising and publicity. They do some of it, but not very much. They do it as it pertains to the platforms they're on. They'll work with you on the trailer, they'll put the trailer on iTunes, they'll put the ads on iTunes, they'll fight for the best placement they can, but you're not gonna see advertising, they're not gonna place any advertising on comingsoon.net or anything like that. That will be up to you. So it is up to you to sort of run the charge, but it will be up to you anyway. Even with a distributor that's doing advertising, because unless you're working something with a big boy, they're going to do as little as possible as well. Gravitas, Film Buff, they're honest. We're not responsible for marketing or advertising. You are. We'll do some, but here's what we're going to do. But they've been really great to deal with, and they're really cool about your timetable, your schedule, the fact that you have to do a delivery to them. You deliver elements to them and contracts, and you have to, you know, get E&O insurance and all those things, but they're really cool about how long it takes to get those things done, and they do find ways to get you the best prices for things, which is terrific. They make, for example, closed captioning. You have to get closed captioning. They have a closed captioning deal, so you can get really reasonable closed captioning done, and basically you just pay the fee and turn the movie over, and it's set up to take care of everything. You can get your own done, but I researched it. It's a lot more expensive. Use their guys, and you literally hand them over the movie. Dialogue list, everything's all taken care of, and it's delivered for you. And you own it. So if you go to DVD, which they only handle VOD and digital rights for us, if you go to DVD with a different company, you own that closed caption. You can take that element and apply it to your DVD or Blu-ray or foreign or whatever else you need to do. They're also really great about dealing with helping develop your trailer and just getting on the phone and just running past ideas. We're doing something called the April Favor Day campaign because we're coming in on April 1st. And we had an idea about, and we're doing a whole promotion for it and basically saying, you know, we want you to try to, if you're gonna rent our film or buy it on iTunes, can you do it on April 1st? Because we wanna try to get onto the iTunes sales charts or rental charts. Because if we do, we're far more visible and it really impacts the way the movie's perceived. It'll help us moving forward with Netflix, with Showtime. It'll, you know, get us in front of a lot more eyeballs. It can snowball into the success we want the film to be just by that simple act of getting on iTunes. And so we ran that idea past them. Like, that's great. Well, we'll make sure we run your promo video. We'll make sure we do this. We should do it this way. Try this. And we're able to kind of refine the idea with them on the phone. Cost them, you know, 10-minute phone call. And we're now kind of more empowered to do what we need to do. So there's sort of they're sort of cool. They're sort of cool. I like them.
Two awards at Sundance, right? For Obsolidia in 2010. Two Spirit Awards nominations, right? Cassavetes. You didn't release the film for 2 years. Do tell.
Okay. I mean, this really bleeds into why I wrote a blog recently about self-distribution. When we got into Sundance,
we were like deer in the headlights.
Yeah, I mean, we had not anticipated it. And then we sort of like, as I said in this blog recently, you know, we looked up on Google, what should we do? And, you know, there's no handbooks, you know, that you get when you get in Sundance telling you, here's how to do this. You know, so we were like figuring it out. And we sort of thought, okay, well, okay, our film has gone in Sundance, so maybe it's going to sell, you know? And like, we're going to go to Sundance and we're going to sell our movie, you know? And we went to Sundance and we didn't sell our movie, you know? There was, I think there
was offers, but like, they were so minuscule. You're like, this is
again
a joke.
That thing where it's like, it's no money and there's going to be no like advertising. So we just sort of, we ended up the first year after Sundance, we just went onto the festival circuit. You know, and we
and
were
took a year.
We were invited to many festivals around the world, and it was great. And we had a great time going to tons of festivals and having a lot of great experience and meeting lots of wonderful filmmakers and
drinking lots of wine and
it was great.
Lots of little hors d'oeuvres,
which ended really with the Independent Spirit Awards. Yeah. You know, that sort of like that was kind of okay. Like we've spent a year now doing this.
That wasn't wine. That was Jameson's whiskey,
which was way
and
more
there
dangerous.
Those massive bottles. Have you ever tried to get through one of those bottles? Those things are huge.
We didn't try either. And so then we just, you know, at that point, and I was still in that old headspace, and I, you know, this has like been a massive shift for me this year, but I was still in this headspace of sort of like, I didn't want to be a producer, and I was kind of like, I'm done with this. Like, I just feel like I'm done with this movie. And with, it's like awful to think about it, but I was just sort of like, you know, I feel like I've done everything I can and I got to move on to the next thing. You know, I got to move on. I'm writing something else. And I went to the Sundance Screenwriters Lab with another project and stuff. And I was just like, I just want to focus on new things, making new things. And so the movie just sort of languished. And it was very lucky then that, lucky that Sundance, you know, started this artist services and reached out to us, which was, you know, their idea for creating a platform for people to self-distribute their films, really, in essence. And they reached out to us and said, you know, did your film ever get, you know, any sort of regular distribution?
Or do you want to be a part of this? And we're like, yes.
You know, and they said, you know, because we'd love your film to be one of the first films that we roll out with this. And we were like, this is perfect for us, you know? And so through that, through Artist Services, basically they negotiated a deal with a company called New Video, who then distributed our movie, you know, digitally and online. I learned so much from this, and I, you know, like we made so many mistakes and did so many things, you know, like in hindsight where I'm like, oh no. And you know, that's why I'm just like, you know, my next film that I plan to shoot this year that we're, you know, we're developing right now. I mean, I'm just like from day one, like even right now, I'm planning the distribution of it.
Yeah.
And it's not, the aim is not to try to sell it to a distributor. Like that, for me, like the model for that, if you're making a movie like Obsolidia, No Stars, again, like an original kind of quirky film. And that was, you know, lots of distributors came to us and they're like, we like your film, we have no idea how to sell it. You know, like, you know, that was it across the board. We, you know, it's a great film, we have no idea how to sell it, you know? And this is the part where I go like about that thing about being a producer and taking responsibility for your work. Now where my head is, and I just wasn't there then. Like for me, just making the movie was like the big thing. Now I'm like, no, now I want to like connect the work with an audience. You know, if you take the time to make a film, take the time to build the audience and to like find them and get that film out to those people. And the magic of these films, I think, like, you know, obviously it's not a film for everyone. It's never going to be a mainstream movie. It's never going to be like a multiplex kind of movie. And the movie we're making this year is not that kind of movie.
No.
You know, we're not really interested in those kind of movies. You know, so we want to make something else.
No, we are. If somebody came along with the, budget, yeah,
but
we'll
I mean, like,
it.
I don't, like, they're not the movies that I go see. They're not the movies that I seek out to watch personally. You know, so like making this next one, I just go like, again, I just want to like create this very niche thing, but take responsibility for it, plan the distribution, and launch it myself.
Some of the offers were just laughable, if not.
And when we say laughable, what it means is you get offered zero money up front for your film, so like absolutely nothing. And the terms in which they're being offered to you are such that really, you know, you'll never see a penny from it, like a penny. And more than that, like you wouldn't even mind that if it was structured in such a way that you felt the company that was taking it was going to spend a lot of money on advertising and really connect it with an audience or promote it. You know, in which case, you know, then you weigh it up. You know, if you have a company that's saying, we're not going to give you any money and you're not really going to get any back end, you're not going to see any money from this, but
we're going to put it in 1,500 theaters.
Yeah, we'll spend $5 million promoting it. Well, that is pretty decent, you know, because that will enhance you and enhance your standing as a filmmaker, you know, because the film's going to get out there. But if really all the distributor's going to do, and that's the kind of, I think the offers that we had, it was really like, you know, it's just really to add to, you know, certain companies' catalogs, where they will own the rights to it in perpetuity, but they're not really going to do anything.
$5,000, $10,000. I mean, it was a joke. I mean, some of it was just ridiculous.
How many offers did you get while you were there?
We had two offers while we were there. And then we had another offer when we got away from there. But they were so, like I said, you know, 5,000, 10,000, you know, really low ball offers.
I mean, we did get one offer, which was a terrific one. We sold the rights to
airline and shipping.
Airlines and shipping. Who even knew? Like, you know? Oh. And so we sold the rights for that. For that, we got $25,000. So that was like, you know, and that was like a decent amount for something that, you know, we wouldn't have any access to anyway. You know?
Wow.
So that was a good deal. But other than that, like actually the sort of selling the rights for America or something, there was nothing that made sense.
And then also on top of that, one of the awards, the Alfred P. Sloan Award, which is the only cash prize award at Sundance, we won that. So that was a tax-free cash prize award, no strings attached. So that was like 20 grand. And that, along with the airline and shipping with the other deal, I mean, that brought us close to our physical budget, you know, that we made the movie for. Mm-hmm. So that was great. The other deals that we were being offered were almost insulting to an artist, any artist, to a filmmaker, to an artist, to a musician, insulting to think that that's what you as a company would pay this person for their hard-earned work.
But it's not insulting, it's just that, I mean, it's just the marketplace right now. You know, it's just the fact that there's so many things out there, so they don't have a huge value.
I think when you don't have a big name actor in your film, you're gonna have shitty deals. I think even you guys, you had videos before we talked about it. And when you have, so I think that's where my film, I'm releasing it on iTunes, Google, Amazon, Vimeo, and for video on demand. I think that's the best way to reach out a lot of people. And if you don't have big names, then distribution is not gonna knock at their door. I had some offers, but again, it's just horrible. I'll do it myself, and I'm gonna make way more money doing it. So again, doing it yourself, if the deals are not right, and if you don't have a name, you're not gonna have a good deal. It's always gonna be like, I'm not giving you money, but it's gonna be 50-50 split. Then I'll do it myself, and I'm gonna have a 100% split, you know? So, but festival is great. It's great to showcase your film, to put your name out there. And then after that, you just hope that buzz, you can use it for sales.
When you say do it yourself, what does that entail?
First of all, I use the company called Juice in Canada, and they are the aggregator for iTunes, Amazon, and stuff like that. That's the thing. In general, what they do, the distribution company, they're going to pay for it. But I paid for it, so it cost me like $2,000. And so that's a big difference. That's the deal they're going to give you mostly. It's like, I'm going to pay the $2,000 for that, and but we're going to make the profits. I'm like, I'll pay, and I'm going to make all the profit. Because I know if the next one, my goal is to have a name so that I can have a good distribution deal, like a big name. That's the goal. And because that's make the big difference. Now, on the horizon for me right now is my business card kind of thing. Like, this is what I can do. And I hope the next one is going to be bigger and a bigger name. I'm still going to use the same kind of team aspect of it, but it doesn't, distribution wise, if you don't have a name, you're not going to have a great deal. So do it yourself, you know?
So this aggregator, what are they doing? They're getting the film ready in terms of,
they take your film and they send it to iTunes. They prepare everything and they send it to iTunes, Amazon, Hulu, Netflix, whatever what. There's a lot of companies like that, but the one in Juice from Canada is pretty cheap. And it's doing the job pretty well.
With the business plan that you put together, I'm sure part of that entailed the distribution of the film and getting it out there. So what part of that business plan, the distribution leg of it, did you feel you did right? And what part would you go back and change?
No, I think I did the business plan myself. And I think the deal that I made with my investor is pretty, you know, I cannot really tell, but it's just me and him that we're splitting the profit, and that's it. So right now, that's what we're doing. So all the money that's gonna come out right now, I'm the own distributor. So anything that's coming in, I'm doing it. I'm gonna get the money. So then after that, I'm splitting with my investor. So, but when you have other distribution, then I would have to split with them, with my investor, with myself. But I think for this one, at least, I wanna make sure that my investor get all his money back before I get paid. That's one a big important thing for trust, and to show that, look, I'm not getting paid for this. It's all about the film first and you guys. So, but yeah, business plan wise, it was more, this is the film I want to do. This is the market, how everything is working right now. Here's some film that makes some of the money that can be, that you can maybe identify with. And mostly it was just like profit between me and him. So it was a very simple business plan. Again, it was, I don't think it's the business plan who really sold him. Yes, it has a beautiful visual and stuff like that, but it's mostly the work before. And right. The fact that he saw interviews of me, that I was in magazine and stuff like that, that was like, oh, okay, he's not just a big talker. He did some stuff. And I think that's way more important than any business deal. It's all about trust that you can do and achieve something.
Well, I think most of my work is really given away. I have a lot of work on YouTube and Vimeo and via my website that is just out there because I wanted to make these projects and then share them and hopefully find an audience with them. A lot of my work is rights challenged, so I don't have the ability to commercially sell it, make a deal. But not all of them, because you know Ernest Borgnine on the bus went on home video. That was, you know, cleared. We have Heavy Metal Parking Lots on DVD. Heavy Metal Picnic is on DVD. I have some other local projects that are on DVD, and I sell those myself. And we have a distributor for Heavy Metal Parking Lot called Indie Blitz. Sorry, mm-hmm. Indie. But the website goes through that. I mean, PayPal does. You know, we're out of the trunk of my car. I mean, but that's, you know, kind of grew out of, you know, the internet and, you know, all the means to achieve this are now in our hands. We can do this. I mean, there's such a seismic shift in the ability to distribute, you know, your own work, whether through digital downloads or hard copies. I mean, that's, you know, creating merch is how people make money and sell it. And you don't have to go through distributors anymore. You have the internet. Allowing you to distribute, and you don't have to then share in the proceeds. But I mean, there's still a benefit to getting distribution. Excuse me, if you can find it and if you can clear it, and that's what I've in some cases been unable to do. So I just share it online. But you know, but things like Heavy Metal Parking Lot, you can buy, and I'm happily, you know. But the thing is. Hey, there's no profit margin anymore. Things are nobody wants to pay, you know, more than $10 or $6.95 for DVD now. I mean, that's what it goes for. I'm happy to, you know, if I can sell it, and some people, you know, will, you know, graciously pay $10. That's I thought a fair price for two plus hours of content. For a 15-minute DVD, 15-minute video. We have a lot of extras on it. But I understand, I mean, the genie's out of the bottle. Everything's up for grabs now. And the internet's the leveling, it levels the playing field for music, video, you know, self-publishing books. But it's still, you know, it's all great, but it also has made a glut. There's a glut of stuff out there. And you just have to, you know, look for it and hopefully find an audience and find some way to sustain yourself and make a living. I don't make a living. I don't live. I have other ways that I work to make a living, but I'm able to support these independent projects and keep going.
So when you made Heavy Metal Parking Lot in 1986, how soon after were you contacted for distribution? How many years later?
Oh, God. Well, it really was, we never made the DVD until the 25th anniversary. So what's that, 2006? So, but the TV show, everything got cleared for the TV show, and that went on in 2003 on Trio, which was a sister channel to Bravo. The Culture Channel, and they made a TV series called Parking Lot, which was a limited series over 2 years where they went to different parking lots, you know, Motorhead, Yanni, Cher, professional wrestling, and we were able to do fan videos in different arena parking lots.
We worked with Roger over at Kino Nation.
And through his help, we got the film up on Amazon Instant, as well as Hulu. And it's fascinating because the Kino Nation system basically allows you to upload your film either at a ProRes or Avid DNX file, and then basically like that upload basically then gets converted to the various you know, codecs and the various ways that, you know, I think Amazon has all these different streaming, you know, if you're on a slow browser, you know, you can watch in full HD. So there's like a full range of the ways that your film has to go out to these different platforms. And yeah, it's been great. You basically set your chapter markers where your ad points are going to come in, and you upload your, you know, your poster file and your artwork file and your synopsis, and you got to have your closed captions, you know, part of your upload. And yeah.
So to all of these digital platforms, were you able to just give them one type of digital file, or did it vary because of, you're saying, these different codecs?
Well, yeah, I mean, Kino Nation takes your one DNX file or ProRes file, and then, you know, for us, I think it was like 125 gigabyte file of the full film in an Avid DNX format. And then basically from there, it's processed through the Kino Nation system and put out to the different places. They work with, you know, Snag Films and Hulu and Amazon. Hopefully, you know, eventually we'll get on iTunes. But then we also put the film up ourselves to sites like Vimeo, VHX, IndieRain. We also have the film on IndieFlix, which is just a fascinating, you know, membership where you're part of the IndieFlix membership and then you get to have access to all the films there. It's the difference between do it all yourself and learn how to frickin' do it first, mm-hmm. which is always frustrating when you're like, okay, how do I do this thing? I don't know. Well, find out. And you're like, okay, this is how you do it. Or, you know, hire someone out that knows how to do it already. And that's the difference between, you know, paying someone else to do it or doing it yourself.
We submitted to a lot of film festivals. We picked the biggest ones, the ones that we were really psyched about going to. Maybe 10, 8, 10.
Oh, yeah. I mean, more than that.
Well, that was like the first round.
That was the first round. Yeah.
And then
fall.
We were like, okay, let's do some other ones too, like second tier festivals maybe. And then there's like 16 of those. So, I mean, there's a lot of costs associated with the shipping and just dealing with that too. And submission fees, obviously.
Submission fees. Copies of films to
and we
mailing. Yeah, I mean, I have no idea how many we submitted to be honest. If there was a lot, there were a lot of festivals that we submitted to, but we didn't get into any.
We got some very nice letters back saying, you know, keep trying, we like your film, there's just not enough room for it, kind of a thing.
Yeah, some handwritten letters. I mean, they send everyone like a letter.
Yeah.
But a couple places like actually wrote us a hand letter. I was like, oh, does this mean something? Like in our deluded mind, we're like, oh, we were close.
Send your submission check next to you.
Yeah, exactly.
Not to mention all of our Kickstarter backers supposedly were funding us for film festivals, and we weren't getting into any.
So we were submitting all of these things. I mean, granted, a lot of those things were also like cost and
of course, yeah,
like ADR work and print material, which we ended up having to still do.
Yeah, I mean, we definitely used all the project dollars towards the project, but you know, when you're saying, you know, help us fund this for our film festival run,
and then we get shot down by every festival. I mean, yeah, there were some long months when we weren't getting into film festivals, but
especially when everybody you see is like, so what's the deal with the festivals? You know, how's it going?
Did you get into Slam Dance? And they're like, no. And they're like, oh man, that film must suck. And you're like, do you know how hard it is to get in? Or did you get into Sundance? They're like, no. I'm like, man, how did you not get into Sundance? And it's, I don't think anybody realizes how difficult it is to get into these festivals. Yeah, there was a lot of heartache getting rejected over and over and over again. But at the same time, we knew that even if we didn't get in, we were still gonna move forward. So, like we always said, no matter what happens, we're gonna do whatever it takes to at least get it out to the public some way.
Yeah.
So
self-distribution is good.
So, yeah, like we were even discussing that. We were even talking about doing a second campaign on Kickstarter or going to the bank and trying to get a loan and doing.
It would have been the third campaign.
For
the same project.
For the same project and to self-distribute. you know, but a lot of that's foolish because we don't have the resources or the knowledge to dive into something as complicated as self-distribution. I mean, it was somewhat fortuitous. I was at the Film Independent Film Forum, and pitched Gravitas the film and showed them the trailer in one of the meetings, and they invited us in to talk, and they decided that they wanted to distribute the film for VOD. And I mean, it was as simple as that. It was sort of, like I said, very fortuitous and sort of odd how quickly everything happened.
So you saw them at the Filmmaker Forum and you heard someone speak on a panel or something?
Well, yeah, because they have all of these panels where different people speak, and I had my iPhone with the trailer. And I went up to multiple people and companies and showed them the distribution houses and showed them the trailer. And
they were like, oh boy.
Yeah, let me get this a-hole out of here.
Watch this.
Yeah. Can you watch my film, please? We were lucky. We just got very lucky. I pitched them the idea and they watched the trailer and like I said, next thing, within a couple weeks, we were already in talks of what the deal was to include. Yeah.
And so it includes theatrical?
No. Theatrical is not through Gravitas.
Yeah, they do VOD. This is just for VOD.
But you have a theatrical distribution or you're...
No, we ultimately did it ourselves.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then how did that transpire? What did you
very
just
lengthy.
Call it?
Very, very lengthy. I mean, yeah, it was months of phone calls and emails.
Follow-up,
hundreds. I mean, at this point, thousands of emails, too. Theaters. And just endless calls trying to get picked up or booked in various cities. And you know, you put all that time in, and you end up with just a few. So it's worth it to us. Mm-hmm. Because we're going to be in about, you know, we're going to run for a week in three cities, Portland, LA, and New York, and we'll have single night screenings in about seven other cities that we've booked ourselves, that we don't have to include anybody else into any of the profits. So that was pretty cool, and we learned a lot throughout that process. That was a very trying, arduous, ridiculous process. Because throughout this whole process, other than Joe running a creative media company and me like writing for the last 5 years, just whatever, we didn't know how to do anything. We just learned. We read books or trial and everything. So if something messed up on the phone or trying to book a theater, then we learned from our mistake and then tried something different the next time until we booked. Because there was so much at risk here with credit cards, I just wasn't going to take no for an answer. I mean, granted, there were far more people that said no, and clearly I had to take their answer, but no wasn't going to stop me from asking somebody else. So I just was very fortunate, especially with the LA Film Forum. They provided a lot of individual meetings, like one-on-one FaceTime, and once I saw there was an opportunity for that, I thought I'd keep the pitch very short and simple and more or less let them decide by watching the trailer if we should continue the conversation. And we had a lot of extended meetings with several distributors for VOD, which was awesome. But like I said, ultimately went with Gravitas. I'm not 100% positive, but I think they appreciated the humor and of our film. And I think they recognized that even although a first film that was very much do-it-yourself with no budget, I think they saw some potential. So,
and I'm sure that also, I mean, I can't speak for them, but, you know, I probably added some diversity to their lineup of films, you know, from no budget to high budget.
Yeah, for sure. So, I mean, I think Yeah, I think they're good people there, and they have definitely gone to some lengths to accommodate our film. So it's been a good relationship.
So we had our world premiere, and then I committed to finishing the DVD, which was sort of like, well, I guess that's really finished, is if you have a finished DVD of the film. So I said, okay, whatever. Finished the DVD. We released the DVD actually the day Burning Man started, 2013. And I actually went out to the playa with 200 DVDs, and I gifted them out to people on the playa. And on that same day, August 26th, we released the film online on our website. So you could actually go to our website and you could download the film instantly, or you could buy a DVD instantly on our website. But I didn't promote. I didn't get the word out at all. I posted one Twitter and I went to Burning Man. My obligation to finish the film had been met, and I had finished the film. And but that's not enough. You know, it's not enough to finish a film. Now you gotta promote. Now you gotta make sure it's out. You gotta get the message out. How does anyone know it's even out? Well, where are these people? Where are the film audiences? Where did they exist? Is it on Amazon? Is it, you know, on Vimeo? How do you find people that want to watch documentaries? And so, yeah, I'm in the middle of a quest. I'm in a quest to find where the audience is. Is it, you know, on our Facebook page, on our website, where they can download the film via, you know, Distrify or Gumroad or these amazing solutions that allow people to just download straight from the artist? Or is it in sort of a bigger arena like Amazon? Everyone knows what Amazon is. So if you're there, it's sort of like it's possible for people to interact with your film. It's possible for people to watch your content because it's in a something that they know of. And I feel like we're in this strange world where, yes, there's amazing solutions right now with VHX and Vimeo and Real House and Distrify and Indie Rain. You can put your film on these platforms and they'll take their 10% or 15% cut, but then anyone can watch your film and download it for $2 or whatever it is. And it's amazing. But you know, it's a challenge of do people know what those are? If I said our film's available on VHX to a normal audience member, they'd be like, don't know what that is. And I feel like some of these platforms are making headway. There's successful projects on Vimeo VOD. There's successful projects on VHX. You know, there's amazing content on Real House, and they just signed this amazing deal with Warner Brothers. But you want to get into the bigger arenas. You want to have your film be available to view on Amazon. You want to, you know, I'm finding it very interesting with Hulu. We put the film on Hulu also, and we don't know our stat. We don't know how many people have watched the film there yet, but you know, just last week we were the 106th most popular documentary on there. So that must mean something, right? There must be some numbers that people are watching it on there. And it's all about trying to find out, like, how do you know where people are and where they're watching content? It's tough. If iTunes allows us into their, you know, deal, then we'll do that. But it's a long waiting list to get into iTunes, and other platforms. I feel like Amazon's been good, Hulu's been good, Gumroad. We do our own digital download via Gumroad, so someone can go on our website and actually just download the full 1080p HD film straight via Gumroad. And Gumroad's nice because they just charge you like a 5% thing and 25 cents or something. So it's like, okay, I can make a deal with whoever and they can take 35 or 40%, or I can do my own version and they'll take, you know, their 8%. But then you're on your own. You know, then you gotta get the word out about your website and have people understand that they can interact directly with you. And I feel like that's still a new concept. It's still, you know, audiences know that they can interact direct with the filmmaker. And I think, you know, there's people that are pushing the bounds on how that works, where a comedian or a filmmaker will say, oh my gosh, I finished this thing, it's available now, $5. And then we've seen, you know, these cases where it's just like, oh my gosh, you know, 50,000 people just, you know, got my film. I think that's amazing. I think that's sort of like the wish for any filmmakers to have that kind of success?
You know, filmmaking was a journey. It's something that I studied, I learned, I wanted to do it. Distribution kind of, you know, came my way because, you know, it's there was no other option, right? In the independent filmmaking world, we are left with so many limited options. And so in that, I also saw an opportunity. If you look at Indian independent cinema, there is amazing art house cinema that comes out of India. And there is not really any company that is focusing on bringing this cinema to North America or internationally. So I met a wonderful veteran distributor, Mark Erman, and he was CEO of Think Film. And we sort of joined forces together, and we say we're going to bring Indian independent cinema to North America. So that's I mean, I'm not an expert distributor, but I sort of took the initiative to start this company, and then Mark is sort of leading this.
Brian, how do you feel about distribution today compared to 2007?
It's very different. Even in that short amount of time. Steel City has been my most successful and widely distributed movie, and that was back when DVDs still had a healthy shelf life and what they call like sell-through or whatever. There's all these distribution terms and jargon, but that was when Blockbuster was still relatively healthy, they bought a lot of units, and you know, that was a tangible thing to see your movie in a Blockbuster. You know. Well, obviously the internet and Netflix has changed everything with all the streaming. Again, it goes back to what I said before. I think it's devalued a lot of things. So instead of being, people are visual, we're visual human beings. So instead of walking into a store or something and seeing like a wall of movies and being able to say, oh, I want to see this or I want to see that, we're at the mercy of what these content providers show us online. So what is Netflix when they get all these new movies? What do they choose to feature? What do they choose to put on their new releases? So we're at the mercy of them. And it's just, there's these things called slotting fees, which is another thing to where you have to pay to be in certain areas or certain, you know, you're basically paying to be in front of people's eyes. And who has the money to do that? The studios. So, you know, it's going to continue to be an uphill battle for independent films. And unless you have a studio acquire an independent film, like a Weinstein Company or a Sony Pictures Classics, who has the muscle and has the resources and the money to get a movie, a little independent film, into the front of everyone's eyes. Unless you have that, you're just like a minnow in a sea of great white sharks. I mean, that's really, and if you're a lucky minnow that can figure out a way to eat, to go to the bottom and like eat a little food and then like go back, you know, if you're able to survive with all these great whites like around, then you're lucky. Otherwise, you're just like, you're out there and you get a little bit of life and then you just get swallowed by a shark. You know, like all these independent films that come out, they're out and all these filmmakers get to say, hey, go see my movie on Netflix. Go rent my movie on Amazon, and it's cool for like 2 months. And then Netflix doesn't renew your contract. The movie's not doing well on Amazon. And then it's just, you know, it's just out there. And then people say, what have you done? And you say, I did a movie called Joint Body. Never heard of it. Well, it's on Netflix and Amazon. Never heard of it. You know, but if you say, I did Captain Phillips. Oh, I saw that movie. Good movie.
To me, I think one of the big mistakes that I see happening a lot is the people premiere their movie at a festival, possibly one of the big festivals, Sundance or South by Southwest or somewhere, and they go there hoping to get a sale, and then it doesn't happen. And they end up, just like us with Obsolidia, a year later thinking, okay, we're going to self-distribute this, you know? And they've really squandered that year, and especially their first launch, which is the moment at which they had the most attention and actually is the time to distribute your movie, you know? And I see this again and again, and I see, you know, people having that moment and they, you know, they don't take it. And I think the biggest, like, I really feel passionately that the biggest mistake is to think that someone's going to come along and take your movie and
do it all for you.
And do it all for you and make it, you know, and it's going to be amazing. And I just think like reality of the world right now, the film world, is there's so much content, you know, there's so many movies out there. Yeah. The distributors are flooded with stuff, you know? And unless your movie has like got something like really, really extraordinary about it, it's not gonna get picked up for a great distribution deal. And this is another thing I think in our industry, is there's a lot of lies, I'm just gonna say it,
misconception about distribution.
You know, 'cause I feel like the way it's all reported, obviously, in the press is to make everything sound great, like this film got this deal. What they don't tell you is it's often a service deal. You know, the artist or the filmmaker is paying the company to distribute the movie. It's not being picked up, you know, like, i.e. the filmmakers haven't been paid any money. You know, and that's another thing. Even movies that are picked up for distribution often, I mean, I hear again and again from filmmakers, they get zero. They get zero money up front, zero. Okay, and the company is taking all rights of the film in order to distribute it. But then they don't do anything that you couldn't really have done yourself. I mean, they're not putting money into advertising it or marketing it. You know, they're giving you zero money to take away the rights because I guess they say that they can get you better placement on iTunes or something. And you know, really, like, I think just one of the things is, like, if you're making a small movie like this, plan your own distribution, take control of it, study this, learn it, you can do it and you can make money at it. And the biggest mistake is to think that somebody else can do it better.
If you've done your homework to do your film, do your homework to distribute your film. It's the same thing. I mean, it's just a different skill set, but it's the same thing in essence. And the other thing about it is that you will then monetize your work so that you can continue to be a writer, director, and get better at what you do. I mean, yeah.
Because this thing of, like, you know, giving up the rights to your film, and really, you know, like, if you could make a film every year or every 2 years, and you retain the rights to them, and slowly, like, they're showing them Vimeo on demand or VHX, and people are paying, and you're getting 90% of the ticket every time that they pay to see your film, you know, slowly, if you build up a few films, you know, you'll be making a living out of it. If you've given the rights away to your movie and you've given them away for virtually nothing, trust me, you're not going to see much money from them ever again.
And the money in perpetuity for films is on the digital platform. The digital platform in perpetuity is where the money is made on films. That's how it's made.
You know, this is the inherent problem of feeling like you have to hand your film to somebody else to distribute it, is they then have the control over everything between your film and the audience and all the money that comes back in the other direction. I know so many examples of the distribution deal gone wrong. It's really disheartening. And it is a further impetus to taking control of building audiences and reaching audiences into your own hands. I can use Justin Simien as an example again. So good was he at reaching his audience, talking to them, building them, cultivating them, exciting them, that he got hired by the company that distributed his film to make all of this content to keep them excited in between when the film got picked up after Sundance and when it was released in October, right? So he got to make more stuff, right, that he loved, and he was the best person to speak to his audience, and that created a relationship of sort of trust and necessity in a distributor relationship. Now, I don't know all the particulars, like, maybe they would say it wasn't all wine and roses, but it certainly looks like it from the outside. I think it is essential to understand that you actually have a responsibility to make your IP valuable so that the distributors are coming to you and then you get to say, I want that one and not that one. And these are the terms of my deal, because you're the one who's really coming with a relationship to the audience. Something that I think, because we get so excited when somebody wants to pick our movie, do your research. Don't ever work with a company that you haven't fully vetted, no matter how much they're breathing down your neck and saying, this deal expires in 24 hours. It's like, well, then you don't get the movie, because I need to find out from the people who've worked with you how it was. I guarantee you this wasn't the first person who worked with this distributor who had a sort of, like, unseemly relationship, you know, had it was treated poorly. So I think it's really important. And I actually see this. I'm really excited in my filmmaking community all the time. Somebody will post on Facebook, like, who's worked with Gravitas? What did you think? And I'll write and I'll be like, I love them. I think Mia Bruno is one of the smartest people I've met recently. And I really like the way that she works on things. Or, you know, hey, I'm having this problem with this company. Has anybody else had this problem? And how do you deal with it? So I think this is when you really have to rely on your community, but you just can't escape doing your research, you know? I'm not saying that it was this guy's fault or anything. It's just really important to make sure, you know, to vet anybody that you work with. Don't take the first deal that comes just because it's the first deal. Make sure that it's the right deal.
So due diligence, research on the net, find out, and also ask other people, post on, you know, or maybe if you don't want to go out there publicly with the name, then you send it.
Yeah, you send it. Mm-hmm. I get these emails as well from friends. Hey, does anybody know anybody here? What did you think of them? What was it like working with them? What's been your experience? You know, Dylan Marchetti from what is now Amplify is one of those people that everybody's like, I love him. You know, and that's really important. That kind of reputation is really important. And the good ones have it and the bad ones don't. Mm-hmm. It's that simple.
Right. So how much time should someone research? I mean, don't just take like a couple days and go, you know, I don't see anything here. Looks good.
Oh, no.
Take your time with it.
Reach out to filmmakers who've had their films distributed through those distributors and get a hold of them. And don't say yes until you've actually spoken to one of them about your experience. You know, I mean, yeah, you can get on the internet and see if anybody's ranted, but you might also, you know, people rant about, look, take Yelp. Your favorite restaurant has 25 terrible Yelp reviews, okay? Right. So, you know, not everybody's experience is your own experience. I think it's important to talk to at least a couple of people and really vet your distributors. You know, they're also getting a good deal by getting your film, right? So you can also take the time to make sure it's really smart. And just don't let people pressure you into taking stuff. Trust your gut. Don't work with people who make your skin crawl. That's important. Seriously, just don't work with people who make your skin crawl.
It happens in a lot of different ways. You know, let's take a typical example. We just got back from Sundance. So we'll take a Sundance film that is lucky enough to get distribution. While they're there, there's interest from buyers. Typically what happens is there's a sales agent involved, and that sales agent will take the lead on the negotiations. And when we get involved is sort of at that same time, but in a little bit of a different role. So simply put, the sales agent will negotiate the material deal points. What rights am I getting? How much money are they going to pay me? How long is the term going to be? And we will come in and make sure that, especially when we've been on since the beginning and we really understand the project, just to make sure that there's no rights that are being granted that conflict with something that the filmmaker has expressed to us before. You know, sometimes we're working on a music doc and they want to retain the soundtrack rights, but the sales agent doesn't know that, and the sales agent gives away the soundtrack rights. And then it becomes a big issue later on, so it's good for us to be involved at that early stage so that we can make sure that the deal is appropriate for the client and makes sense. And then we also come in, again, when there's a longer form agreement to negotiate. We really start delving into issues like delivery. What do they need to deliver? You know, a delivery list that's attached to a distribution agreement can be quite onerous and quite expensive. And if the filmmaker isn't careful to go through that and understand exactly what they need to deliver, it could cost them tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of dollars to deliver a film, and maybe they're only getting in advance of $50,000. It doesn't really make a lot of sense. So that's an important thing that we make sure that the filmmaker understands everything they have to deliver and going through that with them, and then again, all of the terms in the contract.
What would some of those items be that they would need to deliver on?
Well, most of them, which are above my head, but technical items that they have to deliver. Do they need to deliver a 35 millimeter print? Do they have to, what kind of digital format do they need? How many publicity stills do they need to deliver? Do they need to deliver artwork? Do they need to make their own trailer? You know, there's all of those issues that sometimes a producer just assumes the studio is gonna do that. And sometimes they're not going to. So it really depends. In other circumstances, they may want to. The studio may say, we're doing this trailer. We're not trusting you to do the trailer. We're the marketing experts. But other times, they want that stuff to be delivered.
What are some of the typical terms in a distribution agreement, whether it's theatrical or VOD?
So that depends. You know, I guess it doesn't really depend. In all distribution agreements, you're going to have the terms. So how long are you giving them the rights for? And really, you know, we look at that, it's very dependent on money. You know, if you're paying a lot of money for this acquisition, if you're paying $7 million for a film, the acquirer is going to get probably all the rights, and they're probably going to get it in perpetuity. If someone isn't giving no advance, we might say, okay, we'll give you broadcast rights. Let's say you're CNN, and you're giving a $50,000 advance. And this is totally just an example, not true. We're going to say, okay, CNN, you can have the broadcast rights, but I'm retaining everything else. I want the rights to go someplace else to distribute this digitally. I want the ability to monetize this elsewhere because you're not giving me enough money to recoup my expenses, pay back my investors, et cetera.